Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining me today for EBTV. On today's episode, I am pleased to welcome back returning guest Paul Levy. Paul, welcome back.
Hi, I'm so happy to be here. Thank you so much for inviting me.
My pleasure, Paul. And we've had a wonderful show the last time we connected where you spoke about really awakening to the dreamlike nature of our reality. And for anybody who may have missed that, I highly recommend perhaps even starting with that show, as it is a beautiful prelude into what we will be talking about today, specifically as it relates to what is really going on with regards to our humanity or lack thereof, and specifically focusing on understanding the suffering that we are seeing in the world, the insanity really that is playing out right before us, and all that goes along with it, and what can we do most importantly about it. And so for anyone who is new to your work, Paul, I will share. Paul Levy is a pioneer in the field of spiritual emergence, an artist, healer, and founder of the Awakening in the Dream community, as well as author of several books, including Dispelling Wetiko, Breaking the Curse of Evil. And this will be the focus for our show today. And so, Paul, again, as last time we touched upon specifically on your story with regards to your personal awakening and what led you to share the work you are doing today and help so many people in our world, let's get right into things pretty much where we left off last time with regards to, okay, so what is going on Earth with us as humans? And a few times throughout your writing, whether you're talking from your own perspective or citing the work of others, you share it really is a crisis of sanity. What is going on and what's to blame for this?
Yeah, well, we are in the middle of a collective psychosis of epic proportions. And it's so pervasive that it's not even that much of a part of our planetary conversation. And that's an expression of the depth of the madness that has overtaken our species. And what I'm pointing at, and it's nothing new, I'm just a translator for, you know, so many of these traditions, spiritual traditions are saying this just as a modern person. I'm translating it into a psychological sort of metaphor or idiom. The origin, the source of the madness that's playing out in our world through the greater body politic is the psyche. And you know, and that it's such a no-brainer. It's so unbelievably obvious, but yet, from the consensus reality point of view, what I'm saying just seems like so out there and so radical. But you know, so it's kind of funny to me that in that sense that that's how it's what I'm saying is actually taken. But it's so, you know, it's just so clear. So what I'm basically saying is that there's an actual disease in the collective unconscious, but encoded in this disease, it's actually medicine. It's actually helping us to wake up, but it's a quantum phenomenon. And what I mean by quantum, you think about, you know, in quantum entities, they can, like, with what is the nature, like, you know, they can be like a wave or a particle, like with light. It can be both, and how it'll manifest depends on, well, how do we interact with it? How do we observe it? The same thing with this disease, and the indigenous Native American people, they talk about, oh, they have a name for it, Wetiko. That's what the book is about. And they talk about it as being this cannibalistic spirit that just consumes and takes without giving anything back. And they have all these metaphors for it. It's like this parasite of the mind. It's this virus of the psyche. And you know, that's really what is what my whole book is about, what my whole work is about. And it's not just metaphor in the sense that we have, you know, we understand in the physical realm that there are these viruses. And this is a psychic virus. And it operates through our unconscious, through the blind spots, in such a way that we then become the instrument to act this virus out in the world. So we act out our unconscious in a way, so we become the conduit through which this, you can think of it as a higher dimensional entity, but it's not actually, it doesn't even exist. You see, we might experience it subjectively as an entity. That's our experience of it. But like I point out in the book, it ultimately doesn't even have any intrinsic objective existence at all, separate from our mind. And yet, here's this thing that doesn't even exist whatsoever, and it can destroy our species. And that's the paradox. And you know, and the thing about this virus, it operates, like I was saying, through the unconscious blind spot in such a way that it works through the projective tendencies of our mind, because we're always projecting. That's one of the ways of describing when people, you know, say, oh, this is like a dreamlike nature. Well, yeah, just like a dream is an ink blot, and whatever we project onto to the ink blot, instantaneously, the ink blot shapeshifts and reflects back our projection, because it's not something separate out there. And it happens, you know, in an instant. It doesn't even take a half of a second. It happens in no time. And then we become entranced by our own projections in such a way that we then think what we're perceiving objectively exists separate from us. So then we react to our projections. And that, in a sense, that's really the process underlying and informing the Wetiko virus. And it, well, I guess, you know, I can go on for hours about it because, you know, it's my life's work. But one other thing about it, it's a form of like, because it operates through the blind spot, it's a form of like blindness, of psychic blindness. But it's a particular form of blindness in that we actually think we're really clearly seeing. And not only do we think we're clearly seeing, we actually, in an arrogant way, think that we're seeing more clearly than people who actually are clear-sighted. And so we just, and so we, you know, what it does is that it really, you know, it's a source of madness in ourselves. But then the fact that it's, that everybody is suffering from it, we don't recognize our madness. And, you know, and I guess one other thing, because there are so many aspects to it that are so interesting. It's an inner disease of the soul, and yet it explicates itself. It actually expresses itself via the medium of the outside world. So that's an amazing statement. And what I'm pointing at is that somehow there's something in the psyche that actually is able to extend itself out into the world and configure events in the seemingly outer world so as to synchronistically express what's going on inside of us. And that's always happening. But with most of us, we don't recognize that. And then, like I was saying, we become conditioned by our projections in a way we become entranced as if we're hypnotizing ourselves. And that's just a very simple description of how Wetiko works.
Exactly. And, you know, so it's the paradox is really what's, I guess, the first most important thing to kind of grasp is that it's there, but it's not there. And something that you also share in your other writings is that it has the power to induce a negative hallucination. And, you know, many of us understand what a normal hallucination is, seeing something that isn't there. Can you help us understand this from the negative hallucination emphasize that?
Right. And that phrase, the negative hallucination, the sci-fi writer Philip K. Dick, he was the one who coined that phrase. And I just want to say, because I just wrote this recent article about Philip K. Dick's work, he was completely describing to a T Wetiko, but he, of course, was describing it in his own way. And so what he means by when we have like an actual hallucination, we're seeing something that's not there. Well, a negative hallucination is that something is there and we can't see it. So somehow that's kind of what I mean, that it's like, oh, there's this, you know, it works through the blind spot. It's like this blindness. So, you know, as example, I mean, there are many examples, but just the fact that, you know, stuff is playing out that people who are actually seeing, oh, there's like this incredible shadow or there's abuse and it's really obvious. It might be obvious to you and me, but then there are other people who you pointed out to, like say in a family system, if there's abuse. And, or with Donald Trump being a perfect example, oh, you point out, oh my God, he's so sexist and racist and misogynist and on and on and on. But then there are people who just don't see it. They just somehow cannot recognize what to you and I couldn't be more obvious, that would be an example of a negative hallucination.
Yeah, and this is part of what makes this, you know, phenomenon just really actually dangerous, because an effort to perhaps awaken or help people step out of their own self-destruction, they're not only unable to see it, but they're also resistant to the efforts of others, perhaps, or any, you know, efforts of help or healing whatsoever. And, you know, speaking of resistance, something that I think we can bring up right at the start here, because it's plays such a big role, is that while some people are deeply asleep and, you know, that carries with it all sorts of things, but many are awakening, but in their awakening, they are trying to deal with the insanity of the world in ways that are actually not conducive, but actually fueling the Wetiko itself. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, totally. So there are actually two things. I just want to go back to something that you had just said, because the thing about Wetiko, it actually will inspire us to act out in ways that don't serve us, that are actually, you know, contrary to our best interest. And so that's just really interesting. I just wanted to say that, because I think we can all have the recognition that, oh, like when we're acting out our addictions or our habitual patterns, we know they're not serving us, but we do it anyway. So that would be an example of that. But so the thing that you had just said was, if you can remind me, that
with regards to the efforts that many people feel like they're awakening.
Because the thing is that the thing about Wetiko, by operating through the blind spots, it operates through the part of us that actually reacts to our projection. So when we see Wetiko, say if we see the evil playing outside of ourselves, which, you know, it's all around us, and if we react to it from an unconscious place with the best of intentions, with like this self-righteousness of, oh, I want to, you know, I'm on the side of justice and I want to help and I want to bring world peace and I'm a political activist really wanting to, you know, be compassionate. But if we're reacting out of our unconsciousness, we're actually unwittingly, even with the best of intentions, feeding Wetiko, because Wetiko, it feeds off of polarization. Okay, so that's why some of the best people I know, they're spiritually, you know, very, very interested in spirituality, they're political activists with the best of intentions, but they're unwittingly serving as a vector to actually feed the disease that they're fighting against. And so that's one of the ways that Wetiko then, because it actually is contagious, and it'll propagate itself in a non-local way through the field via people's unconscious reactions to it.
Yeah. And another big part that plays a big role here is deception. Deception on a personal and a collective scale that Wetiko carries. Can you talk a bit about that?
Yeah, totally. Well, in other traditions, they'll have, you know, they'll give these names to Wetiko, and they'll say, yeah, these are like these you know, kind of incredible, like a master of deception. That's what these entities are. So, because if you think about it, we ourselves are like these geniuses at deceiving ourselves. And one way of understanding that, you know, because we all do it at certain points in our lives, but, you know, we can tell a lie and we can start to believe our own lie to the point where we don't even know we're lying. And then we're in denial that we're in denial, and it becomes a feedback loop and we can't see it, because if we see that we're doing that, it would blow our whole gig of being in denial. So then it becomes like an autonomous self-generating process of deceiving ourselves. And if I'm deceiving ourselves, and if I've told myself a lie and I believe my own lie, there's a certain charisma I have that's very convincing to other people. So that will easily entrance other people to like actually fall under my spell and to have an agreement with me. And you see, the thing about Wetiko, it can absolutely affect an individual person, but it's a mistake to just think of it as a pathology that, oh, that person has and I don't, or other people, we don't and they do, because it's a collective psychosis. And it's important to understand that the evil of Wetiko, it works through the collective process, through a group, through a species, through a nation. So that's the way that it will actually propagate itself. And so that's kind of why it's important. Yeah, any one of us at any moment can get taken over by it and can actually, you know, in a sense, embody the disease. But if we see a person in that state, and if we think, oh, well, they have Wetiko and I don't, well, Wetiko, if you remember, I said it feeds off of polarization, it feeds off of separation. So the idea being, if you see somebody who's embodying Wetiko, if you have the understanding, oh, and they're a dream character. Dream character is in a dream. Any character in a dream is an aspect of ourselves. If they're a dream character, they're actually an embodied reflection of that sick part of me. Then all of a sudden, you've cut through the separation, and you're actually engendering compassion. And compassion is really the energy that really dispels Wetiko. So that's just a little bit. I mean, I can go into this I do in my book so much more deeply.
Yeah, and well, I mean, the very nature of humility is brought up so prevalently here. And, everything that you're talking about now, and again, also in your book, it brings a whole new meaning to that idea of we are one. Because if we can't see that, all of us are carriers of the Wetiko just by being human, right?
Right.
Is that if we can't see that right in others and bring ourselves to that level of humility that, hey, under any different circumstances, that could have been us. But it isn't, right? That does help us to cultivate that compassion. And in your book, you share that compassion is actually cultivating compassion is one of the ways to increase and enhance our lucidity in this dreamlike nature of reality. So right. I'd love for you absolutely to talk a little bit more about that.
Yeah. Sure. Totally. Well, I'll just give you a personal example. So I don't know, this is probably, in the 80s, in the early to mid 80s, I began having these dreams, at night. And I began to have the recognition that I was dreaming and I was having these lucid dreams. The very first one I had, and every single, not every single one, but almost every single one from then on, at the moment of lucidity, but it was particularly got my attention, the very first one, at that moment that I realized in my first dream that I had lucidity, that I was dreaming, spontaneously from the core of my soul, I began chanting a mantra. And I was such a beginner at Buddhist practice, I wasn't even doing this mantra. I didn't even know it. The mantra was Om Mani Padme Hung. Om Mani Padme Hung is the mantra of compassion. And then the second lucid dream, same thing, Om Mani Padme Hung, as soon as I recognized I was dreaming. And then as I began more developing in my Buddhist practice, I was receiving teachings and they would say, oh, when you have real genuine awakening, it's a co-joining of two factors of what's called having the recognition of emptiness and compassion. Well, the emptiness is lucidity, is having the recognition that this universe you're in, that it doesn't exist objectively separate from your own mind, that there's no intrinsic existence from its side at all. And that's the emptiness. And the compassion, well, Om Mani Padme Hung is the mantra of compassion. So here in the dream, as I was having the realization of emptiness, spontaneously the compassion was coming out. And what they say in the teachings is that if it's a real awakening, it's never one or the other. It's never just the realization of emptiness without the compassion or the compassion without the realization of emptiness. The two are always like right there together. And so that's kind of why when people ask me, oh, how do I, see more of the dreamlike nature of reality? And there are all these ways of doing that. But one of the major ways is cultivating compassion in yourself. That really, it's like feeding that lucid part of ourselves.
Yes, absolutely. And such a beautiful approach too, in terms of how we then treat ourselves, treat other humans, how we think and look upon other humans. And of course, all animals and plants and life forms on earth and earth itself. And so such a big and beautiful message and part of healing and going beyond the basically clasp or clutch of Wetiko. Now, you also mentioned, that idea of emptiness and of course, wholeness is where we want to get to, basically outstepping outside of the duality or the polarization. What we're seeing, of course, playing out in, again, our human family so often, and on the level of that emptiness is, again, that psychic or spiritual emptiness in this regard of the Wetiko. And I see, and this is evident to pretty much all of us in one way or another, the dysfunctional relationship we then have with material objects like food, like alcohol, drugs, material items, shopping, etc., in an effort to fill that void. Right. Can we understand this a little bit better and how this is all stemming from that Wetiko expression?
Yeah, sure. Well, the thing about Wetiko, one way that I describe it in the book, it's an eating disorder. It's a psychic eating disorder where we're trained by our culture to consume endless consumption and consume, whether it means to buy or to ingest and take inside of us to fill that void that can never be filled. So then it becomes insatiable, where, you know, it's like having an addiction, where the very thing, or it's like being in trauma, that the very, like our very reaction to trauma is the very thing that actually is creating the trauma that we're reacting to. And it becomes a self-perpetuating feedback loop. So, you know, what you're pointing at is that, you know, so many people, they're investing their energy in doing everything and anything to get away from experiencing that voidness, you know, inside of us, that emptiness, but that emptiness actually conceals a fullness. And that's kind of a similar idea that here Wetiko, which is the source of the greatest evil that our species is perpetrating on each other, ourselves, and, you know, on the whole, you know, sort of planetary body politic, but encoded in the Wetiko, you know, or encoded in that emptiness, the same thing, is actually, you know, this jewel, this gift. And of course, how it manifests depends on how we observe it. But that idea of that endless consumption, I mean, it's like when somebody is bit by a vampire, they become a vampire, and then they try to vampirize others, you know, but it can never be satiated. It's an insatiable thirsting or craving. You know, that's, in a sense, that's the shadow part that's getting acted out in the world. And, you know, if it develops enough sort of energy, I mean, it can destroy, we are destroying the biosphere. We as a species, we are actually creating, we're in a collective fashion, we're killing ourselves. I mean, there's no question about that. And it blows me away that not more people are actually talking about that or thinking about that. But the point is, encoded in that process, we're killing ourselves as a way to figure out how to not kill ourselves, which we clearly haven't figured out how to not kill ourselves, or we wouldn't be killing ourselves. The point is that encoded in the pathology is the medicine. That's the key. That, in a sense, is the underlying theme of the whole Wetiko book that I'm writing about, and that it's a quantum phenomenon. Like I was saying, it's in this superposition of states that both the poison and the medicine are right there combined, and which one is going to manifest, it depends if we have the recognition. Like the point is, something is being shown to us by what we ourselves are acting out in, you know, all over the planet. And if we don't have the recognition of what's being shown to us, we're just going to continue to destroy ourselves. But once enough of us recognize, oh, there's something being shown to us, and that will precipitate an expansion of consciousness, then all of a sudden, then we can actually change the dream. And that's evolutionary. And that's what's being offered to us, you know, through this whole, like, the Wetiko epidemic.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, before we get even further, because the cure and the healing is, of course, the bright light at the end of the tunnel here, if we could say it that way, you know, that, yes, there is something we can do. And before we go further into focusing on that, I'd like to just, you know, emphasize the aspect of what you were sharing and what really your book and your message and calling to others is all about, to awaken. Because, you know, it is a dream, and it is virtual or a simulation, but it doesn't belittle, or we can't belittle, the fact that people are suffering. Nature is suffering, you know, so many species, Earth is suffering. So with that in mind, there is an urgency here for us to do something about it. And, you know, being, of course, you have an expert, or you have a background in economics as well, and topics dealing with that, I know you have a lot to say also with regards to how this insatiable hunger and obsession for more is related to how we do and deal with the economy on Earth. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, well, for sure. And the thing, okay, because that's a big topic, and actually in the Wetiko book, there's a whole chapter just on the economy. But one of the things about Wetiko is that it's described as a counterfeiting spirit. Well, actually, in the apocryphal text of the Bible, they talk about a counterfeiting spirit. And that's Wetiko. And what that means is that it will imitate, for example, it'll imitate us, it'll shapeshift and take our form. And then if we're not awake in that moment, we'll then identify with Wetiko's image of who we are, this limited image. And then we've become like a channel for Wetiko to operate in the world. Now, just think about the economy. the way the economy right now is operating, it's not this, in a sense, so much of what's happening in the financial world is like sort of this bubble economy. It's not a real economy. And it's not where like, oh yeah, we're creating like genuine wealth and abundance. No. It's just all of a sudden, just like these, you know, money is moved around that doesn't even actually have intrinsic, you know, sort of this value. And it's this game where people, it's like this, you know, whatever you call it, was it three card Monty or something, where everything is moved around to create this image of wealth being created, but there's actually nothing there. So the point, what I'm trying to say is that the way the economy is actually being enacted, it's kind of like it's a counterfeit of what a real economy is, which has to do with the harmonic exchange of good and services in a household. That's what the word etymologically economy means. And so so what I would like to point out is that, you see, the thing about Wetiko, be it through the channel of the economy or as an individual or collectively as a species in our relationships, it can only operate if it's not being seen. It's what I was meaning before when I said it operates through the blind spots, through the unconscious. So one, what that means is that if you think about Wetiko as if it's an entity, it can't stand to have light shed on it, to be seen, because just like in the myths where there's a vampire, the vampire, once the light of day comes up, it has no power, it has to hide. That's symbolically really showing that's the Wetiko right there, that if you actually shed light on it and see how it operates, not only through the world, but in your own mind, all of a sudden, two things happen. You've taken away its power and you empower yourself. And then Wetiko is out of business. And so that's kind of why the profound importance of actually being able to see it. And, you know, to see it, oh, you can look at it through a number of systems. Like I was saying, individually, through relationships, or through the economy. There's all these different ways of seeing how it will actually operate in a system, and it'll aberrate the system. You know, the thing it does, and this is important, for example, in the human psyche, it's like this pathological entity will come into the psyche, and it will co-opt more and more over time the healthy parts of the psyche to serve its pathology. And then, you know, the person so affected, because it's operating through their unconscious, they'll have no idea of what's actually happening, that they're being taken over and actually of service to some sort of darker forces. They themselves might subjectively feel, oh, I've never felt more myself. And meanwhile, something's coming through them. They're just an instrument of this darker unconscious force to play itself out. And the whole point is that when you begin to see that, that's where you actually begin to become free of it.
Yeah. And, you know, some irony here is that it needs to be seen in order for us to be able to have an effective means of dealing with it and transcending it and liberating ourselves.
Oh, totally.
And yet this topic of darkness, of evil, Wetiko, and however we choose to see it, is one that makes many people very uncomfortable to talk about. And I know mentioned that a little bit in our last show, and you see this in your work. Can you enlighten that?
Sure. And that's one of the ways that Wetiko works. For example, like I just reconnected with an old friend who I haven't seen for like 35 years, and he's a brilliant guy, a PhD, and he didn't know much about Wetiko, so I sent him an article, the one I sent you on Wetiko, and he read it. And his response was, oh, you know, this idea of Wetiko, it just doesn't appeal to me. I'm more into just feeling gratitude and joy and all that. And I found that really interesting, because it's great feeling gratitude and joy. But yeah, the idea of Wetiko, it of course it's not going to appeal, the idea of you know, the darker forces or evil. But that's one of the way Wetiko works, because that word, like evil, for example, is so charged. And people have such a reaction, and a lot of well-intentioned people who are real spiritual people, they're like, oh, I don't want to even give evil the time of day. I don't want to put any of my attention on evil. Well, but by being in avoidance of that, they're unwittingly feeding the very thing they're not wanting to look at. And so, so that's one of the ways that Wetiko will then further propagate itself through our unconscious reactions you know, whatever. So the point is that what I point out again and again is that the idea people are talking about, oh, I want to awaken, I want to be filled with light. Well, light has no value at all unless it will, you know, show us the darkness. If light doesn't, you know, shed light on darkness, well, then what's its use? What good is it? And so the point is that if the darkness, if we're like, you know, kind of turning a blind eye and not dealing with it, well, then we're secretly empowering it. So all I'm really talking about in essence is just to actually bring awareness to the shadowy energies that we are colluding with. Keep in mind, that's another part of the book that is really important, I think, that this isn't something out there that, yeah, there's this, you know, these darker forces whose source is within ourselves. But if we're not actually shedding light on it and bringing awareness to it, then we're complicit in the very darkness that we're complaining about and that we're reacting against.
Yes. And that's, again, you know, something that, I mean, all of us can relate to and understand on one level or another, in that we don't like to not, you know, feel good, generally speaking. We are very good, as you pointed out, and as many people who are at least aware enough of themselves and can self-reflect enough know, that guilt doesn't feel good. It doesn't feel good to actually think of, wait, how did I actually impact that person, right? Right. How were my actions impacting them? But this is, of course, part of that identity attachment, part of how the ego can sabotage our own well-being and become self-destructive entity. Can you talk a little bit about that aspect of how this has such a strong attachment to our identity and why we don't want to see it?
That's such a great question, because see, and that's another thing, like built into the phenomena of Wetiko is this counter incentive to actually see our own complicity. Because, oh, it's painful. It actually will create some form of trauma. It'll bring up a feeling of guilt. So then if we don't have the courage to be able to face those, like, those, you know, it's, oh, that's like negative. Well, yeah, there, you know, to awaken, you have to, you know, you have to face your own shadow. You have to see your own complicity in your own suffering, in the evil that's playing out of the world. So what the thing I'm saying is that, you know, built into the whole dynamic is like this counter incentive to do that. And so then people are would much prefer to, oh no, I'm gonna blame out there. I'm gonna see the evil out there, you know, because then they can feel unconsciously in this righteous way, feeling, oh, well, I'm good and the evil's out there. But that projection of the shadow is the way that Wetiko actually is animating itself and keeping itself in business. And if I could just say one thing about that projection of the shadow, because that's the psychological sort of like process that underlies the whole phenomena of Wetiko. So say if I'm not in touch with my own shadow, the part of me, this inferior, the darker part of me, I mean, it could also be the light part of me that I'm not owning and I project that onto, you know, that guru or whatever, but it's typically like this darker, more, you know, the part of us that we just don't like. And so say if I'm split off from my own shadow, I'm not owning my own darkness, well, then what's going to happen? I'm going to project it out, right? Now, just if we can take a step back, if I'm in a dream and if I'm not in touch with my own shadow and I'm projecting out my own shadow, well, what's going to happen in that night dream? Well, into the night dream will walk somebody, you know, or a number of people who will be carriers of my shadow, because what is the dream but my own psyche just expressing itself through the medium of the dream? So here's walking, in walks somebody who's like embodying these darker forces that I've split off from and projected outside of myself. So take a look. Now I have evidence. Oh, the evil is out there, because I have all the proof I need, because they're embodying, you know, the very evil that I projected outside of myself. So then that will like even more entrench me in my viewpoint that, oh, well, the evil is out there, because now I have evidence that it's out there. So then I become even more fixed in that viewpoint and more project the shadow. And the more I do that, the more they're going to manifest in a dark way. And it becomes a self-perpetuating feedback loop whose origin is my own mind. So the point is that that's what we're doing in our waking dream. That if any of us are projecting our own darkness outside of ourselves, being dreamlike, this universe is going to then supply the evidence of like that the evil does exist outside of ourselves. and like I just described, then we become even more, you know, fixated on, oh, you know, there it is. And then what we do, we try to destroy the evil that exists outside of ourselves, which itself is a reflection of the initial impulse to get rid of our own darkness. And the more we try to destroy the evil out there, we are actually becoming possessed by the very darkness that we're seeing outside of ourselves and trying to destroy. So we've unwittingly become taken over by the very Wetiko that we're fighting against. What I've just described is the actual dynamic of how Wetiko operates.
Yes, and that can, you know, give us an easy example of how insane it is to try to bring about peace or fight terrorism, right, by creating a war. And in thus,
oh my God, totally. And that's a form of trauma. I mean, think about in trauma, like I was saying before, you know, so something happens historically in one moment in time, for example. And then if there's trauma, then how we react to that trauma is the very thing that actually is creating, you know, the very trauma that we're reacting to. So we're actually putting fuel on the very fire that is the repetition compulsion. Then we compulsively act out the very thing that isn't serving our best interest, like I was saying before. So the thing about Wetiko, it is a form of trauma. It's related to being addicted. It's, you know, it's underlying all of like the self-destructive tendencies. Because the thing, you see, one other way of understanding Wetiko is that one of the ways of really being able to free ourselves from it is to connect with being creative, with expressing ourselves creatively. But there's a fine line between creativity and destruction of self or other destruction that I know for me as an artist, you know, as a writer, if I don't express myself creatively, then I watch, and in subtle ways, if my creativity isn't being expressed constructively, it gets expressed destructively, and I'll just act out in these subtle ways. And you see, because the thing about Wetiko, it's not a personal energy. It's an archetypal energy. It's a transpersonal energy. And one way to understand that, it's a higher dimensional energy. And it's, in a way, there's a word, it's this, you could say, daimonic energy. That word, the daimonic is a very interesting word, because etymologically, in the daimon, the daimon actually means the guiding spirit, and it's our ally. It's etymologically, it has to do with genius, with calling, with vocation, with hearing a voice. All of those things are related to the daimon. And the point is that if we get in relation to the daimon, and encoded in the daimon is the creative spirit. If we get in relation to the daimon, we'll find our genius, our calling, we'll hear a voice that's guiding us, we'll find our vocation, all those things. But if we don't connect with our daimon, it'll constellate negatively if we like marginalize it, and it'll become a demon. And a demon is what the indigenous people, that's in psychological speak, it's called an autonomous complex. It's a split off part of the psyche that develops an autonomy and seems to be, you know, having an independent will or life of its own. That's an autonomous complex. Indigenous people call that a demon. That's what Wetiko is. But yet encoded in that whole energy is our creative spirit. And that's the profound importance of expressing ourselves creatively.
Beautifully put. And you know, this makes me think of the line from your book that really stood out for me, in that you share, whatever the soul does to itself, it cannot help but do to others.
Right.
And so it's beautiful when it's positive, but if we are not using that creative energy constructively, then we are not only destroying our own sense of being, but we are also destroying the good efforts, let's say, of others. Because again, if we are self-destructive, then we are also externally destructive as well.
Yeah. And one way, I mean, just like, I'm so glad you brought that up, because like how I first saw that was in my family with my father. But the point is, if somebody is taken over by Wetiko and it really establishes themselves in their mind stream, then in a sense, they're killing their own soul. They're complicit in killing their own soul. When they meet somebody outside of themselves who is actually a carrier of light, that will like unconsciously be a reflection of the very light that they've killed in themselves, and they literally can't stand that. So they will actually, in an unconscious, compulsive way where they can't help themselves, they will actually act out to destroy the light they see that somebody else is carrying, because it's too painful for them to have that reminder of the light they've killed in themselves.
Yeah. And so again, the solution, the cure, the healing here lies within us becoming awake and lucid and being able to look and face our own shadows, face our own darkness. Because, you know, there's too many people in our world that keep thinking that the problem is outside of ourselves, right? And I'm sure you're familiar.
Well, I could just say something about that. That's, you know, the sponsor of that is Wetiko. Wetiko, it will actually convince us that the problem is outside of ourselves. And like I was saying, because of the dreamlike nature, as soon as we hold that perspective that the problem is outside of ourselves, then being like a dream, the universe will supply all the evidence that the problem really is outside of ourselves. And now there's no doubt in our mind. We have all the proof we need. Oh, it really is outside of ourselves. And so, but then if you just think about it, then Wetiko is like off to the side, and it's getting off on us we're distracted by putting all of our attention and energy outside of ourselves, and yet it's being fed by us doing that. And the whole point is that when we begin to realize, oh, the evil I'm seeing outside of ourselves, wow, it's a quantum system. We have a reaction to the outside. Well, our reaction isn't separate. You can't separate out what's happening on the inside and the outside. And actually, they're actually like reflections of each other. And if we then turn our attention on our own darkness and shed light on, oh, what inside of us is being triggered by the evil I'm seeing outside of us. But it's not just that one person is doing that. But imagine if you're doing that and I'm doing that and other people are doing that, and we're actually cultivating that compassion, lucidity, whatever you call it, and then we connect with each other. That's where our power lies, you know, because we're under this illusion from, like, you know, what's playing out politically, that, oh, I just, so many people feel helpless and powerless, and oh, what can I do, or all that. But we have, I mean, I just wrote a book on quantum physics, and one of the revelations of quantum physics is the profound, unbelievable power, the creative power inside of our mind, and to actually influence the way reality manifests. And as one person begins to wake up to that, and two people, and three, and 10, you know, and one way to understand that, just go back to the metaphor of a dream at night. Imagine you're in a dream and you have lucidity and you've recognized that you're dreaming. Then there are all the other dream characters in the dreams who are aspects of yourselves. And imagine there's more and more of them, as 10, 100, 1,000 of those other parts of yourselves, they also are having lucidity. And then imagine connecting with each other and contemplating and, you know, just thinking about what you're realizing. Oh my God, this universe, this dream universe we're in, it's actually not separate from our own consciousness. We're literally dreaming this up moment by moment into materialization. That's what quantum physics is revealing. That's what quantum physics is showing us. When enough of us have that realization, we could put what I call our sacred power of dreaming, which is the power we have to dream the dream into materialization moment by moment, we could put it together consciously in a way where we can change the dream we're having. That's evolution, and that's not just a metaphor for a night dream. That's what's available to us in our waking dream.
Yeah, and this is the exciting part. This is the wonderful part, that again, we do have a solution. We do have a way to heal and to cure. And, you know, as you mentioned several times, and you share throughout the book, you know, that the source of this Wetiko, it's, again, we have to emphasize, it's not somewhere out there, it's within us. And, you know, I like how you also share that since we created Wetiko, we can also uncreate it. And that's what you're also tapping into here in terms of how we, you know, create with our psyche, with our mind, with our consciousness, this reality.
Right. Totally. It's like, I mean, you know, that is pointing at, and that's what quantum physics is discovering, that we ourselves have an unbelievable untapped power of creativity. But in a sense, what Wetiko does, it's turned like that incredible, like, you know, that creative, like, you know, the genius that we all have to create our experience moment by moment of ourselves and the world. It's, in a sense, one way of understanding Wetiko, it's turned that genius against us in a way where we've imprisoned ourselves. And, you know, And so many people are just walking around in this incredibly, like, this larval, limited state of despair and depression and powerlessness. And then they just compulsively act out in a way that feeds that particular, you know, that state. And so the thing that I'm pointing out in the book is, as we add more awareness into that very process, and that's not a process outside of ourselves, that's a process inside of our own mind, then all of a sudden those same energies that are animating, you know, our suffering, we could actually access in a way to express love and compassion and be creative. And this isn't, you know, I mean, it's so funny to me, you know, when people, oh, gee, you're like this new agey guy, or this has nothing to do with that. This is, you know, every tradition based on having this wisdom. I mean, I think of Castaneda, and he has Don Juan talk about Wetiko. He doesn't call it Wetiko. He calls it a different name. He says, this is the topic of topics. There's nothing more important for shamans than understanding, you know, this. And that's true. This, if we don't come to terms with Wetiko and what it's showing us, guaranteed we're going to destroy the, you know, our species and the biosphere. I mean, that there's no doubt about. So it's just, you know, I can't recommend enough. I just wish I was more articulate to try to get across the profound importance of, you know, really understanding, you know, and it doesn't make a difference whether you call it Wetiko, or the Gnostics called it the Archons, or the Hawaiian Kahuna called it something different. You know, every tradition has their own name for it. It doesn't make a difference, the name, but it's important that you find, like, one name that actually really speaks to you, you know, to give you awareness of what it is you're pointing at, because Wetiko operates through the shadows. It's very tricky and it's elusive. And as long, you know, even in mythology, in fairy tales, they always talk about the profound importance of finding the name for the offending demon, that once you find the name, but it has to be the right name, the proper name. Once you find the name, it takes away the power of the demon. And Wetiko could be understood as it's the name, you know, of actually what's ailing our species.
Yeah. And that, again, facing up to it and being not in fear of it and keep denying and ignoring it.
Oh, it feeds off of fear. That's the thing.
Exactly. But having that courage to face it, say it, and thus transcend it. And, you know, this makes me think of everything that you've just shared, as you beautifully share in your writing. Wetiko can literally destroy our species through wrenching poverty, endless war, and catastrophic environmental destruction. Or, and here's the beautiful part, if confronted, named, and understood, it can introduce us to the dreamlike nature of reality, which changes everything. Yep. And so, as you've been so beautifully pointing out, there's that creative aspect, there's that awareness, there's that compassion, cultivation also of mindfulness, and another big ingredient here, imagination. Can you speak a bit about that?
Oh, totally. Sure. So many of us in you know, our culture, which doesn't value imagination, hear the word imagination and just think, oh, it's just imagination. That's really not real or anything like that. But, you know, all of the wisdom traditions talk about that the source, the basis of our experience of ourselves and of the universe, the source is the creative imagination. And that when you think about that, all of the works of the greatest works of art and of science, you know, like in quantum physics, I could not believe, the more I studied it, the more like the greatest physicists, you know, from Niels Bohr to Einstein to John Wheeler to Richard Feynman, on and on, David Bohm, they just couldn't say enough about the profound importance of creative imagination in really discovering whatever science they were doing. And, you know, so I think it's important to understand that, in a sense, it's the primordial phenomena. It's the way that we interpret, you know, here we're in this universe and, you know, we are the ones who are generating what is the meaning of the universe. And then the way that our minds work is that as soon as we interpret the inkblot in a certain way, it will then offer all the evidence to show us, oh, to give us the proof, oh, that really is, you know, that way. But it's easy for us to become entranced. So in a sense, our imagination, you know, through the creative imagination, we can easily entrance ourselves if we don't, you know, plug into it in a conscious way. And so, for example, people who think, oh, the imagination, is not real. It's just a figment of our, you know, of it's nothing. Well, and they'll become convinced of the truth of that. Well, the source of that experience is their imagination. And so that's like the irony of it, that the imagination, they've used the imagination to prove to themselves that the imagination is like nothing. And it's just so mind-blowing, you know? So one thing that is having to do with the imagination that I think is really important, in Tibetan Buddhism, they have this incredible teaching that I've kind of made into four words. And the four words are, as viewed, so appears. That as you view something, that's the way it will appear. Now that's like an equation for how we actually co-create reality. And think about it. Think about that's an expression of being in a dream, that if I hold a perspective in a dream, the dream, it actually being nothing other than my own mind, will instantaneously shapeshift and reflect back the very perspective I hold. And then, but the thing I'm saying is that if we're not awake to that process, we easily can entrance ourselves into the object. Oh, that's objective. That's out there. And then we just react to it in that. Then we've become a vector for Wetiko to actually incarnate. And you know, the whole idea of quantum physics, that's what quantum physics has seen through. Classical physics was convinced there was an objective world and that we were separate. And quantum physics, you know, empirically has proven that's complete nonsense. There is nothing objective. The act of observing the universe is actually influencing the universe we're observing. The observer is the observed. That's a description of a dream. So the as viewed, so appears. If somebody hears that teaching, so, you know, I guess one way to think of that, if you project onto an inkblot, the inkblot, it doesn't take 2 seconds to then reflect back how you view it. No, the very instant you view the inkblot is the very that same instant, it will manifest as what you're projecting. And so if I, you know, explain to somebody the as viewed so appears and you know, the whole teaching and what it means, and if they think, oh, that's BS, that's crazy, as viewed so appears is not true, well, guess what? The universe at that moment will reflect back to them that as viewed so appears is not true. And then they'll take that as confirmation. You see, I'm right. As viewed, so appears is not true. But what they don't realize is that it's actually confirming the profundity of the as viewed, so appears. So you see, it's that whole idea that our mind is such a genius and so creative. But Wetiko, it plugs in a way where it imprisons us through our own creative genius. And all that I'm pointing at is like, wait a second, what if you just like shed light on that dynamic? You then actually access your creative genius in a way that's going to serve you and is going to serve the world. That's the solution to Wetiko.
Yes. Oh, I love those connections, because that's just it. You know, I see all too many people imagining the worst with, let's say that we are right now, you know, here in Canada, but for you in the US, many people though around the world are focused on the US election and imagining the worst case scenarios. Others are focused on what's happening, for example, in parts of the Middle East. And again, imagining others focused on the environment and imagining the worst case scenarios. But imagine if we turn that around, right?
Yeah. Well, that's the thing. In my book, I talk about if we view things in this pessimistic way, then we're unwittingly an agent for Wetiko. Because if we view things pessimistically, we're not aware that we're then increasing the probability that then things will manifest in a pessimistic, in a negative way, which will then confirm the seemingly objective truth of our pessimism. So then we have all the evidence we need, like I've been saying. Well, no, I'm just in touch with reality without realizing, wait a second, but you're actually somehow informing the very thing that you're reacting pessimistically to. So you see, that's kind of why it's really important for any of us to not fall into, you know, pessimism, despair, depression, to see things negatively. It's very, very seductive and very convincing. I mean, things seem like it's like unbelievable the times we live in. So it's really easy to get hooked by how terrible things are. But if we do that, then we're complicit in actual, you know, on all the negative stuff that's happening. So that's kind of why, like for example, for me, because I know so many people who can't even watch the news. They get so freaked out. They get filled with depression and despair. Where I'm really into watching, you know, the most horrific stuff in the news, because on the one hand, I want to understand what's going on, and I want to see, at least on the national news, how's the propaganda being presented. But also, I've developed this capability in myself that as much as the negative is happening in the world, instead of falling into despair, it's actually stimulating this bodhisattvic impulse in me even more to try to even more be of help. And that, I think, is a muscle that we all can cultivate. You know, when you see the horrors that are playing out, just take your pick, Syria, you know, anywhere, you know, instead of falling into despair and having it confirm this negative viewpoint of no, having it even be more of an inspiration for us to like find our voice and to be of help.
Yeah. And so, Paul, this makes me think of the one final big question that I would love to ask that perhaps many people are also thinking, you know, at the end of the day, why all this challenging hardship? Why can't we just, you know, be here and have fun? And something that you pointed out already, and you point out many times in the book, that even though this Wetiko, this idea of the evil spirit, the disease of the psyche seems, you know, like, yes, it's a challenge. There's no doubt about it in various ways and forms. But perhaps it serves the very purpose for our awakening. And so you ask at the end of the book, you know, is Wetiko taking us down or waking us up?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, and so, you know, one of the things that I say, that I point out in the book, is that if Wetiko didn't exist, we'd have to invent it. It's actually unwittingly serving the evolution of our species, because it's like, you know, with like, if there's some sort of a germ or like, you know, a virus or something, and, you know, it will, you know, it begins to mutate. Well, Wetiko forces us to mutate relative to it. So it's actually in a secret way serving our evolution. So all of these traditions, like the Kabbalah, I think of, comes to mind. It talks about that the source of the greatest good is evil, that without evil, that encoded, and this is, you know, in alchemy talks about this, Gnostics talk about this, Buddhism talks about this, that encoded in the poisons is the light. And you actually have to extract the light that's sort of hidden within the darkness. And so that's, in a sense, because it's easy just to think, oh, how come, why is this all happening? Why can't we all just get along and blah, blah, blah? But this is actually serving our evolution, but it only will do that if we have the recognition. It's showing us something. This is this how the world is manifesting. This world is an oracle. It's like actually, you know, revealing something to us. And if we don't get the message, same thing, if we have a dream and we don't get the message, it'll be a recurring dream and it'll be more and more amplified form, more and more like scary until we actually get the message. And then once we get the message, we no longer have to have that dream. Same thing in our world. There is something, you know, that actually is being shown to us through what's playing out, and it's being shown to us symbolically. You know, and symbols are the language of dreams. And, you know, and that's why the profound importance of cultivating symbolic awareness, of seeing the dreamlike nature, of interpreting this as if it's a dream. What is this showing us? What if I had, say, whatever happened today for any of us, what if I had that day? What if I had dreamed that last night? How would I interpret that? What parts of myself were showing up? What is that showing me? We can actually take that perspective and view our life in that way, that symbolic awareness. And just one other thing, the word symbol, it's actually the antidote and the antonym to, so there's the word diabolic, and diabolic means that which separates, that which divides, like Wetiko. Symbol, what does symbol mean? It means that which brings together. So the idea being that developing symbolic awareness, symbols being the language of dreams, is in a sense the antidote to actually the evil of Wetiko, okay?
Yeah, and we can also then work also symbiotically together.
Right, I love that, totally.
Well, thank you so much, Paul, for everything that you've shared. This is really, again, such empowering, enlightening content that even though it's not always pleasant to hear about, talk about, perhaps even to self-reflect within ourselves, but so integral, vital nonetheless. And so, Paul, for anybody who's joining us and is interested, okay, great, you know, this really resonates, I can feel it, I can see it, perhaps they've been doing already their own shadow work and would like to get involved on some kind of a community or greater scale, what can you share in terms of any initiatives taking place?
Yeah, well, on the one hand, you know, they can go to my website, and, you know, so I'm in I'm in the Northwest, in the Pacific Northwest. And so I have all these groups that I facilitate all week. I have a whole community of work that's formed, you know, just with reference to my work. And, but I'm super into connecting with people. And, you know, for me, the idea of as we more and more connect with each other, for people who are waking up, you know, and put our creativity together, you know, and who knows what that's going to look like. I can only imagine what it would look like. But that I just can't encourage people enough to like plug in that way. Because the thing for me, one of the scariest things would be in this world with this, with the insanity that's going on, to feel isolated and not to feel connected with other people. And even in Tibetan Buddhism, they'll talk about the three jewels of the foundation of enlightenment, the Buddha, Dharma, Sangha, teacher, teaching. And the Sangha is the community, that profound importance of connecting with other people who are of like mind, in the sense that we can help each other to awaken. So I don't, there's not any particular specific structure except just to connect with each other. And then we can create whatever form, whether it's, you know, a new form of activism, or, you know, a new form of like art, or I have these awakening in the dream groups, or, you know, publications, or whatever it is that we can dream up and create together to be a benefit. I can't encourage that enough.
Beautiful to hear. And so for anyone who may be interested, Dispelling Wetiko, Breaking the Curse of Evil, now available at, of course, all major online retailers and perhaps your local bookstore and or even library. And an important book for our times, really, to dive right into the depths of what is going on and how we each play a role and how we can each be the solution. And so, Paul, anything else to share as we wrap up in terms of your website or any final closing words?
Yeah, well, okay, I guess one thought that I was having, because the importance, like the fact that Wetiko, it operates through the blind spot. And so, you know, the way of really healing it is to see it. And there are three ways I want to point out, and they're all this interconnected as far as to see it. So first would be to see this being a collective dream, to actually recognize this is like some sort of mass shared dream. The second is to see the field, that there's a non-local field, that's a physics term, you know, that actually it's almost like that we're contained, that this universe, this 3D universe is contained in some sort of higher dimension where there's no separation. That's the non-local field that quantum physics is really more and more like pointing at. So seeing the dreamlike nature, the non-local field, and then the third of the three aspects is you have the recognition that we're not separate, that we're actually interconnected and interdependent. And out of those three, seeing the non-local field, the dreamlike nature, and seeing that we're not separate, out of that, the energetic expression of that is compassion. And like we were saying before, compassion is the Wetiko dissolver par excellence. So anything that any of us are able to do to cultivate compassion, to see the non-local field, to recognize we're dreaming, and to see through the imagination of that we exist separate, that would actually be of service to the whole world.
Wow, fantastic summary. Thank you so very much, Paul, for sharing everything you have, and of course for forging forward and being such a light also in the midst of our world today. Thank you so much for being here again with us today.
I can't thank you enough. It's totally been my pleasure. So thank you so much.
You're so very welcome. And thank you also, everyone, for joining us. And as always, if you'd like to share any comments, questions, or feedback, please feel free to do so in the comments below. And also share around this message so that, again, we can bring light to the darkness and begin to creatively, constructively imagine a new and better world. Thank you, everyone. And until next time.